Welcome back to Stationeers. I got a few comments on the last video saying I connected the generator in the wrong place, so I've moved it. Happy now. I put a transformer here that doesn't appear to be working, but actually is. And we have basically that connected into our two batteries with heavy cable, and heavy cable is also coming at the back of the generator. Not that this is, it kind of needs it because if these can generate, you know, five kilowatts, that cable is not enough for more than 5 kilowatts, so you have to move to heavy cable. I didn't want to do it all the way along the line, so just put a transformer in the way, and that should just keep things separate. I suppose you could use APC or anything really to just to separate the two. No real problem there, and it is charging the batteries, as you can see, so that is working despite the fact that the green light is not on. It doesn't seem to register a power draw on this side. Anyway, the generator is not on because the program is not on, because the other comment that I got was, hey, you can change this battery reader and not need a program at all. So I will give you a reason to get a program, because I want to use this IC generator here. So a reason to use a program if we can change this. So first of all, let's change this, and then I'll show you why we don't need it. So from the comments, here we go. Stationary battery, I used the sum. If we use the average instead, and I did cycle through that last time, you'll see that that represents pretty much what we've got here. We've got 3 full and 1 very nearly empty, and we've got a value of 0.72. So that's accurate. And we don't need the number of batteries anymore, which means our computer program can be a little bit simpler. I'm not turning it back on yet. Let's just change this. So I don't need the number of batteries anymore, and I don't need a lot of this. So let's just take a look. We want to load in from the battery ratio, which is the device, this battery down here. We want to load the battery ratio, and that's fine. And then we don't need to necessarily deal with the number of batteries anymore. So we can get rid of that line. Okay, so we can then do this multiplying again, and let's see what that actually outputs. So let's just turn that off, export this, and turn this on. And whoops, that's not good, is it? Yep, that's multiplying. That's into very large numbers of zeros. Clearly something's gone wrong there. Let's just grab this edit again. What have I done wrong? I've pulled in the battery ratio. That's fine. Multiply the battery percentage by the battery percentage. Let me just correct this. I'm multiplying percentage by percentage without ever setting the percentage, and I pulled it in here for this. So what we can actually probably just do is, we don't even need the battery ratio anywhere. We can just say the battery percentage, I guess. There we go. And we can get rid of one register. There we go, 72.8. Corrected. Easy. And there is an even easier way of getting around this multiplying dividing thing. I'm not going to worry about it for now. It can stay as it is. Instead, one thing we can get rid of is just R0, or in fact we can rename R1 to R0, and then just have one value up there. And now I'm going to add the reason for the program. Yeah, Schmitt triggers. So Schmitt triggers should be quite simple in code, but less simple if you use chips through this. So let's just define a high trigger. Okay, already have plans for this anyway, so don't worry. So a high trigger. We have to then change down here. Let's just get this separated. Where before we could just basically do one thing, a one or a zero, we have to assess where the battery percentage is and then do something. So we're going to change this instruction entirely. We're going to need to use, and let's just move this over, a couple of potential functions. What we really want to know is if, let's just see. We want to skip something if the battery percentage is too low, okay? So if it's too low, we want to skip it. Let's just go, I guess, down here. We want to get to the branch if less than or something like that. Branch relative less than, BRLT. It's down here somewhere, BRLT. So relative jump to line C if A is less than B. Okay, so BRLT, if the battery percentage, and at this point it is, remember, it is corrected, so it's in a value from 0 to 100, so we don't have to worry about fractions or anything like that. We could do it earlier than this, and then only multiply later, but it doesn't really much matter. Either way around will work. So, let's just see. If A is less than B, so we want our battery percentage, and then low trigger. And then we want to jump forward, let's just say two lines, okay? So the next line is if it is higher than the low trigger. So if it's higher than the low trigger, we want to set the device on. So set diesel generator on. In fact, we can just get that line. And we're not assessing emergency power anymore, so we're just going to set one. I can get rid of this line entirely. So at this point, what it's going to do is if it ever gets lower than the lower trigger, it turns on and never turns off. That's not so great. So we need to be able to turn it off again. So let's say branch relative greater than our battery percentage, high trigger, and then branch jump forward two lines, and then set solid generator on zero. Isn't that easy? So basically, as soon as it drops below the low trigger, I forgot the right way around. Battery percentage is lower than the low trigger. It's going to skip forward two. No, that's the wrong way around. Okay, that's it. We'll remember we're skipping, not anything else. So if it's greater than the branch relative greater than. If it's greater than the low trigger, skip forwards. Otherwise, i.e. it's lower than it, basically turn the generator on. And if it's less than the high trigger, skip forwards. And then it's going to set it to zero otherwise. So as soon as it's above the high trigger, it turns it back off again. And in the middle somewhere, it'll retain whatever state's been set. So that's something to not really worry about. So what you're really looking for is this to be turned on here, and everything should be good. Now, it's currently not going to basically turn on because our high trigger and our low trigger are set either side. So if I set this to 75, this should actually turn on. So there is 5 coal. It's dark, so let's go and find some more coal. That's going to be lead, isn't it? Yeah, coal. There we go. 40. Not that we're going to need a huge amount, but you get the idea. Let's just put 45 in there. All right. So when I enable this, hopefully it should turn on. Yep, that's fine. Export. So on it goes, and you'll see the power starting to build. Now, it's going to pass its low point, which is 75. It's going to go all the way to 80. Or at least it should do, except for these batteries are full. That's something we have to guard against. So you're going to need to be turned off for a second. Turn you off. That's a problem. Now, if we hook up this generator to all the batteries, that won't be a problem. That's probably the simplest solution other than doing something in code. Because I don't necessarily want it to feed to just two batteries. I just run out of cable coil. So I'm going to just do something off camera. I'm going to go and figure out a way of getting that cable over into here. Probably the same way. I'm just going to put, you know, an APC or a transformer or something like that. Nice and connected right there. And then we may have to move this display, maybe not, and get that into heavy cable. Back in a second. Okay, let's try that again. Now everything's connected up the way I think it should be. Let me just make sure that transformer's on. Yep, and that is 71.9. So, yep, you're getting a charge from something. It's nearly dawn. Let's switch the program back on. That should turn. Yep, you see 163. That should change. So let's watch it go up. Why won't we change the triggers a little bit? Let's just change this to, let's say the high trigger is 75 and the low trigger is 70. So we just export that. There we go. So it should still have triggered. But now it should stop when it hits 75. And here it is, it's approaching 73, 74, 75. And there it goes, it's stopped. It won't re-trigger, even if it falls, you see. It won't re-trigger until it drops below our low trigger. So let's just say that low trigger should be 50%. Okay, So 50 to 75 is a large enough band for the Schmitt trigger to really function properly. And that's that pretty much done. So, yep, you now have that in a couple of chips instead of the more chips you'd need to do this if you did this with just circuits. So that is a reason for an IC. So, yes, I appreciate the previous program didn't, but yeah, now it does. So now we have some guard against our power. We should figure out some way of using that power. Okay, here's the beginnings of the hot gas furnace. I've not built it inside because we want sort of a test platform out here. And all you guys can comment on this as normal. So we've got basically an active vent providing some atmosphere, nothing else. And this is going into this pipe, which is connected to two air conditioning units, okay? The left one is set to minus 99, the right one is set to plus 99, okay? Air conditioners take their inputs and try to transform their outputs to whatever you set. So this one is trying to set 99 degrees on the far side. This one, because it's facing the other way, is trying to set minus 99 on this side, okay? Now, the waste outputs of air conditioners basically deal with whatever the excess is. So this minus 99 one, in order to lower the temperature of this gas, which is currently 36 degrees, and there's quite a lot of it, and it's doing it by pulling in from the input side. Remember, it's not actually transforming what's in this pipe right now, but this pipe right now is going to go through this one as well, and it's in a closed loop at the back. So we have a continually circulating air, sort of gas. So yeah, it is trying to transform this eventually to minus 99, and this one is counteracting it. Now, in order to do that, it has to dump heat somewhere, and it dumps heat to its waste port, and its waste port is this one right here, and it's going up and into the furnace. And that waste port is currently set to 125 kPa. And you can see its temperature is rising. Well, slightly falling now. But it was rising, I promise. And that's sort of limited by, I think, this one and the amount of gas over here and stuff like that. But the important thing is that the furnace can't, well, in fact, the air conditioner, it fills its waste port if there's nothing already in there. And it fills it up to around 100 kPa. And yeah, the temperature is fluctuating because so is the pressure. So it's, what was I going to say? Yes, so it can only really fill this port to about 100 kPa. It stops then. It's part of the point of a furnace. So you, not the furnace, the air conditioner. So you can fill this pipe with anything you like, but that won't actually fill this and pressurize it. So you have to additionally pressurize this to get this going. Now, there's a couple of ways we could do that. One is we could try and use the output of this to keep filling it. And we could do that with a pump that forces everything above it to get even more pressurized. That might be something we can try. Let me get a pump. Can we actually fit this in the existing volume pump? We'll do gold and copper. Let's grab some, in fact, I didn't want to do that. I'm just going to grab some golden copper from the inside. Let's put that away, because I had some copper basically being done. There we go, copper and gold. And let's put these in. So one volume pump, and I'll see if there's room for this. That should be done very, very quickly. That's some pipe. I didn't need that, thank you. But thanks for that, I guess. Volume pump. There we go. And let's just grab a wrench. Will that volume pump go in right there? It looks like it will, which is good. Assuming I can actually get power port to the right side to be connected. That seems like it'll do the job. So below that will now pressurize to 100 kPa. Above that will probably be at 100 kPa. But if we just grab some... is that heavy? Is that light? That's light. I want heavy. It's heavy because all this is directly connected to the batteries. There isn't a transformer in the way because it can pull quite a lot of power. And they are, which is why you're seeing these batteries deplete. However, our system should kick on soon once it hits my low, which is 50. Not that will save the system because these things can pull huge amounts of power, but I just want to actually test this. And next episode, we'll probably deal with the sort of the... coding side of things if we need to. So let's just get some more cable coil. Okay, and that's why I didn't want to dump the gold and copper out of here, because, whoops, I didn't want one cable coil, I want more than one. Why is that dumped? Oh, because I pulled the lever. That's fine. So I only need a few of this. And let's just grab our cutters just to splice it into the main cable. Give me a couple. Well, it literally gave me a couple, but okay, let's just splice this in. So we just really need one more. There we go. I can get cut off for now. And we get a corner. Okay, so that can go away. You can go back in here, and here we can grab this. And note that the other side of things, this is where the hot gas will go out. This is a cold pipe. It's because this is trying to increase the heat, it's basically pulling heat from somewhere, and it needs to pull it from this pipe. So this is the output of the furnace. You'll see that's at minus 138 right now. So as soon as that heats up again, it'll be able to pull more heat from it. Right now, it's probably not able to do that. So let's turn the volume pump on, and we'll see what happens. So at the top here, you'll see this is 100 kPa right now, and its temperature is... well, that's why you... Let's just actually increase this a little bit. Okay, and let's just take a look at what the output is. So that's one. Oops, I'll get the pipe. Pipe network, there's nothing in that one. And there is 93 in this one. So that may not be enough. And what are you? You're static. Okay. And what have we got here? 5.24 MPa. And this side we have very little. So maybe I should add to this side as another sort of active vent. I'll move this one over. Maybe I'll make another active vent just to pressurize the whole system, and so it has available pressure to do whatever it needs to do. For example, like fill that. It doesn't have much pressure on the input here, so let's just make sure we have enough in there. Whoops, as I did some recabling, I have to remember to hit the start button on the air conditioners again, otherwise they don't actually work at all. Anyway, I did pressurize this side just because I wanted to make sure that they were both, you know, decent pressures. And this side is increasing because it's coming out of one way and going the other way. So we have a look here. This is at 89, and this one is now 100, 100 and 200. Yeah, it is trying to pressurize. But the temperature is rising as well. Remember, you can see that going up. And below this, you can see it is actually filling. Oops, when I get to the pipe. Pipe network, come on. There you go. So it is trying to fill, but the volume pump is taking all of that and pressurizing the furnace, which is exactly what we want. Of course, we do want the pressure in the furnace to be quite high, and you can see it's rising there. So we have a system basically capable of pressurizing a hot furnace. So next episode, we're going to think about doing this a little bit more rigorously and getting it to a certain pressure and temperature. But the basis here is pretty much done. Once we actually activate the furnace or run something through it, you'll see this is lowering temperature right now. It is also raising in pressure. Is that raising in pressure the same as this one? Looks to be roughly connected, although the temperatures are not connected, so that's interesting. So, yeah, I presume there's internal valve in there that's stopping that from happening. That's perfectly fine. And yeah, so I'm going to leave it on for a little while. Remember, these things do hoover up the power, so you've got to be a bit careful with that. You can, of course, use a pressure regulator here. It is just a little bit, well, quite a lot slower. And it is drawing quite a lot of power from the rest of the system. So it if that hits 50, well, this whole thing will kick on, which is why I built this first, because furnaces are going to be power hungry, let's put it that way. Now, the alternate way of doing this is the way I did it in Season 2. If you want to do it in the way I did Season 2, I'll describe it. I'm not going to do it in Season 4. I'm going to try and perfect this system, which is a way of getting hot gas without using consumables. So, yeah, we can use the furnace without ever spending stuff I need to mine, basically. We can just pull it straight from the atmosphere and use power to actually do it. So how is the Season 2 variant going to work? Well, if you want to do Season 2, what you want is something more like we have inside at the moment. You want a furnace that's encapsulated probably inside an entire block that's solid. You don't even want it to contact any kind of atmosphere whatsoever. Because what we're going to be what you would do is you create a room like this, where it's fully enclosed, not just this opening at the front. And you would, inside that room, put lots of wall heaters, just like we have in our greenhouse. Over here, you have a wall heater. So you have a room with wall heaters in it, and you pressurize that room with whatever you like, probably pollutant from wherever you get the pollutant from our atmospheric unit. It's a good heat transfer gas, basically. It transfers heat a lot nicer. And you pressurize that room to whatever you like. Let's say 100 kPa. Doesn't matter. And you raise its temperature. You raise the temperature to whatever you want the furnace finally to be. So let's say that's 1,000 degrees. You heat that room until it's 1,000 degrees, then shut off the wall heaters. You can do it with the program if you like. That's not a problem. And then inside the room, I'd suggest doing this before you heat it up to 1,000 degrees, but inside the room, you put lots of pipe. And I mean lots of pipe. You want the pipe running up and down and up and down as much as you can. And then on each section of pipe that you can fit it, put a radiator. And then send the two ends of the pipe outside that room. And the two ends of that pipe are going to be connected to maybe a large gas tank. And you want to pressurize that tank with whatever gas you want to heat up for your furnace. I'd suggest just atmosphere. Don't even bother with, on Mars, certainly, just atmosphere. On Europa, it's oxygen, so I wouldn't suggest using that in on Europa. But on Mars, just use CO2, or pure CO2, or just use atmosphere. It's perfectly fine. You can then just fill up that tank with active vents or whatever you like. And then that, because it's connected to the pipes into the 1,000 degree room that you're going to temperature control, it will slowly start heating up through to 1,000 degrees because the radiators exchange the heat with whatever's in the room. So eventually you end up with a hot gas in a tank with large connected amounts of pipe, which means there's a large volume of gas and there is a large number of moles probably, at 1,000 degrees, and then you can feed that into the furnace whenever you like. Whenever you want to pressurize the furnace to a certain pressure, all you need is a simple pressure control, like a regulator. And behind it, the temperature, you're going to have to watch out whatever temperature you need to set. You need to kind of modify that, because remember, temperature changes with volume, so you got to be a bit careful. But otherwise, you can see this one is already going up to where we want it, really. So its temperature is reaching 500 degrees. So quite happy with this so far. I'm going to turn this off because it consumes power like crazy. You need to keep probably one thing running. I think when I read this on Reddit from a user called Thexafall, you need to keep one of these running. And the other one, whenever you want to get the temperature higher, you just turn that one on as well. But in this case, we're just going to turn everything off because it all consumes power. So I'm just going to leave that off until we come back to it next episode. So hopefully that is straightforward, closed loop. And in the middle, you want the minus 99 one and waste to go to the input, the plus 99 one waste to go to the output. So the heat's going to come out here and be recovered into the system. The heat's going to go in here. And remember, this waste side is going to input heat. This waste side is going to absorb heat. Otherwise, just pressurize the system with just some active vents or whatever you actually want to do. And you have the basic basis of a system. And this, of course, is the basis for all of you guys to start commenting like, you can't do this. Yeah, that's perfectly fine and indeed very welcome. So more than happy to hear your comments. For now, though, I think that's pretty much it. We've got everything I wanted to cover. The corrections to the power system, and I have a nice little sort of prototype area out here before we rebuild it inside some walls, which is what we'll eventually do once we've got the system perfected. Yes, so things like having this whole thing insulated inside blocks is important. It's not out here, but that's just because it's a prototype and I don't really care that much about it. So hopefully that has given you some insight. So obviously a bit of a shorter episode today. I want to get just some building done rather than too much programming. And we're going to have to deal with some corrections and some some programming next episode. So I'll leave this one a little bit short and then we'll get to the sort of control for that furnace to try and get it up to the exact right temperature. We're going to need two temperature ranges, remember. We're going to need one for general alloys and one for invar. So just like we have here with its purge control, for this furnace, we're going to have the same thing here where we need a high and low pressure lever. But we can probably automate the rest because we don't really need an activate and a purge so much. I don't think. We'll have to come back to that anyway. But yeah, that's pretty good. So I'll see you next episode. As always, guys, thanks a lot for watching. Give it a thumbs up if you've enjoyed the episode or if this gives you some ideas of your own for your own manipulation of the atmosphere and Stationeers physics. Otherwise, we'll see you next time. As always, guys, thanks for watching.